It's all right. Here I am in Kerala speaking about Devanagari and Sanskrit. Well, Sanskrit is very important in Kerala, but there is not a one-to-one relationship between Sanskrit and any one alphabet. Sanskrit, the classical language of India, the Latin and Greek of South Asia, was always written down in the local alphabet, and usually phonetically. So you will find Sanskrit medieval manuscripts from Orissa in the Oriya script, in Bengal in the Bengali script, and of course in Kerala you'll find all the Sanskrit manuscripts in the university up here. They've got a fabulous library. They're almost all written in Malayali script. So I'm talking about Devanagari, which is the script that's used in the northern area of India, in Delhi and Maharashtra. So I'm a little out of place, but still, it's perhaps the most widely used script for Sanskrit. So there's some justification. And many of the problems for typesetting Devanagari are the same for the other Indian languages. So I'm going to be talking about ZTEC, Jonathan Kew's adaptation of TEC. And there are many interesting and powerful features in ZTEC, but the one that converted me about 2 years ago, 18 months ago, was Unicode. I mean, this in my field and with the world and the web and everything, there's no way that I can't work in Unicode. For a long time, people in my field studying classical Indian languages have struggled with private or semi-private character sets, and we've developed whole suites of little programs and utilities to convert from one to the other, and it's just been an ongoing nightmare. And finally, there's Unicode. So one can, for example, find something in Sanskrit on a website and cut and paste it into one's document. Well, okay, then you need a document that's an editor that's Unicode aware. Then if you want to, say, put it in your BibTeX data, in your BibTeX data file and use it as part of your bibliography. Let's say you want to cut and paste a bibliographical entry for a book from the Library of Congress and just use it in JabRef in your bibliography, in your BibTeX bibliography, and just have it as part of your Sanskrit and English or Sanskrit and German document. These are all the things we need to do today, and it really has to be Unicode. So it has to be Unicode going in, and it also has to be Unicode coming out. I need to be able to produce PDF files that I can give to my colleagues, and they can cut and paste, they can select and cut texts from my PDF if necessary that will make sense with their editing programs. So it's okay, it's one thing to produce a PDF that looks right and prints right, but nowadays I also need one where you can cut and paste from it and still get Unicode out of it, at least from most of it. And if you just used CMR and 8-bit input, then you get very funny results when you try and cut and paste. So Unicode going in and Unicode coming out. And so what I'm going to present now really is just a mashup of my solutions and my understanding of how to proceed with all these wonderful tools that have all been created by other people. There's one other wrinkle on this, and that is that in India, Sanskrit is pretty much synonymous with either Devanagari or the local script. But a lot of people think of Sanskrit as the same as being the Devanagari script, a bit like, you know, Russian is Cyrillic. Cyrillic is Russian, although there's Ukrainian too and many others. But still, somehow or other, there's a unity there. And the average Sanskrit knower, and there is such a thing, believe it or not, in India, will be sort of, you know, somebody in Calcutta will kind of get it that people in Kerala will write Sanskrit in Malayalam script. But almost nobody gets it in India that in Europe and in America we write Sanskrit in the Roman script. But there's a 150-year-old tradition of doing so. So there's a typographical tradition with a real heritage now of doing Sanskrit in Roman script. And there are journals and books and things going way back, and it really exists. So that also is something that I use daily in my professional work, and that many of my colleagues do as well. So there's doing Sanskrit in Indian scripts, but there's also doing Sanskrit in Roman script. When you go out into town, you'll see many shops which will say something like Krishna Bazaar, let's say in Roman script. They may often say Krishna Bazaar in Malayalam script also, but Krishna Bazaar, and it would be K-R-I-S-H-N-A. So that's great, and that works, and it's no problem, and I have no argument. However, in scholarly work, there, at the World Congress of Orientalists in 1898, a scheme was worked out for representing Sanskrit in the Roman script, one-to-one, letter-to-letter, one-to-one, that has pretty much stayed standard ever since. So it's really great. I mean, this is something in Sanskrit, in the logical studies, that's very different from Arabic. There's a German way of transliterating Arabic and a French way, and they fight like anything, and they won't agree. And Tibetan is translated in about three. Chinese, as you know, there are numerous different ways of representing Chinese, Wade Giles and others. So for many languages, there's a sort of, there are turf wars about how you represent them in Roman script, but not in Sanskrit. In Sanskrit, it was decided by academics at the academic level that we would write Sanskrit in Roman script in this way, and with almost no difference that has stayed to the present time. So that's great, but it isn't K-R-I-S-H-N-A. We use a series of diacritical marks that map one-to-one with the Sanskrit alphabet. And that scholarly transliteration now has an ISO number, 15191, I think. And that is, again, almost unknown to most people in India who would write something phonetically using the phonetic rules of English. So you'd like write Krishna. So Maratha speaker will pronounce Krishna with more of an U sound at the beginning, so Krishna. So then you would typically see K-R-U-S-H-N-A if you're in Mumbai or Pune, whereas in other parts of India it may be written slightly differently according to local pronunciation. So all of those local uses of what in India really is the English script, I mean the Roman script, those don't apply to scholars who use a series of diacritical marks with acute accent, tilde, and dot underneath a series of letters. So that's something that in my professional field we want to be able to do. And then there's hyphenation. And this is tricky. The hyphenation rules for Devanagari are fairly straightforward, more or less hyphenate after any vowel, roughly speaking. I mean, there are some exceptions, but it's much simpler than English. This 150-year-old tradition of typesetting in Europe and America developed a quite different way of writing, where words were hyphenated etymologically. So scholars got very used to dividing words at the end of a line according to the meaning of a compound word or according to the grammar. So you wouldn't break halfway through a suffix, you'd break just before it, so it made grammatical sense. Whereas in the tradition of Devanagari writing, you can more or less break anywhere and the reader will be comfortable with it. So in a way, the rules for hyphenation are much more relaxed in Indian scripts than they are in the Roman script. This is, you know, the hyphenation of transliterated scholarly Sanskrit. It's getting into rarefied air, but then there are quite a lot of people who care about this and get angry and reputations in learned journals in Germany, etc., etc. So for one group of people, it really matters. And then the tools, this collection of tools that I've mentioned that have been created within the tech community are now having spin-offs into XML and web presentation of text, which are really nice, and I just want to just end by talking about that very, very briefly. So ZTech can provide this Unicode input and output, easy access to system fonts, so you just have to put a font in the right directory and ZTech can deal with it. You have to be careful about the correct name of the font, but once you know the name properly, then you can just call the font and use it, which is bliss. I mean, that's heaven. ZTech has this system of permitting string pre-processing. So you can write a file in this TECKIT, TechKit system, which lets you fiddle with things before they're fed to tech. And I'll show you one particular use of that. And thanks to FontSpec, and especially FontSpec, and Polyglossia, wherever they are, somewhere, I don't know, I put them somewhere now, I can't find them anymore. Doesn't matter, but there are these two packages which are really superb and support this whole, everything I'm going to say really comes out of font spec and polyglossia. And they're very powerful, very sophisticated, very slick, very nice to use. Little learning curve there, but they're very, very good. Carol has just talked about how he was struggling a bit with the Babel and the multilingual support within LuaTeX, and really for ZTeX we have got very smooth packages now that pretty much replace Babel and make it much easier to work with many languages at once. So I would like to give you an example here of the simplest case. Let's begin input here with document class, simple, begin document, end document, and in the middle we've got some Sanskrit that looks like this, which is just, I'm writing with a Unicode editor and I'm assuming that we've solved all the problems about typing. I use Ubuntu, people with Windows and other, all sorts of different ways of having keyboard handlers and things. It's all a bit system dependent. It's really quite easy in Ubuntu to set up keyboards so you can just type in Devanagari if you want to. And also the second line there, the romanized transliteration, Asid Raja Nalo Nama, Sanskrit says the same thing, Devanagari says the same thing, is the scholarly transliteration with macrons over the long vowels, so it's Asid, not Asid, or you know anything else, and Raja, not Raja, or Raja, or Raja, or anything else, it's just Asid Raja Nalo Nama. And actually the rhythm is a poetic meter which has a kind of bounce to it, so the length of the vowels really matters. So let's say we type that. So we're not using any package. I'm just saying begin document, end document, and I'm typing in Unicode, and I'm going to give it to ZTeX, and ZTeX gives me this. Your Sanskrit input looks like this. So far, so good. And then my Devanagari has disappeared. And your romanized transliteration looks like this, and all my accented characters have disappeared. So ZTeX is typesetting my work, that's good, but it's not understanding Unicode. So the very first thing is to tell it to support Unicode, which is done through calling polyglossia, which itself calls font spec, which calls Los Moores X Unicode package. So there's a kind of Russian dolls situation here, and polyglossia is calling all these other support systems. So now, same file, no change at all, and there's the output. And your romanized transliteration looks like this, and we've got our romanized accents, but we have no Devanagari. Why not? Well, if you, your font here is computer modern, and computer modern just doesn't have Devanagari letters in it. So we're dealing here with a font that is not fully populated. It's Unicode and all, but that it happens to have empty boxes at the places where the Devanagari glyphs would be. Quite a lot of Unicode fonts that are like this actually print a little empty square box, or a box with a cross in it, which is jolly helpful. It's much more helpful than just seeing white space. So then you really know you've got a font that has blanks at that position. Okay, so now we want to load a font that has Roman and has got Devanagari. And there's one font called Nakula, which is written by a friend of mine from Cambridge University, John Smith, who wrote a pair of fonts, slightly different design, called Nakula and Sahadeva. And those of you who are versed in Sanskrit mythology will get the joke. They're a pair of twins, Nakula and Sahadeva. And so now we've got polyglossia supporting the Unicode. We've got Nakula, which is a fully populated font, and here's our output, which is very nice. It's almost nice. But can you spot the deliberate error, those of you who know Devanagari? I've put in an extra word there, this word kartsnyam, which is a word that is a very good word for testing whether or not your font is doing its ligatures properly. So in Roman script, we're used to fi as a ligature. So f plus I becomes a third character, becomes a ligature character. Fl, ffl, and so forth. We've got a small set, and in older typesetting, ct, and sometimes S at the beginning of a word would look like, in older texts, 18th century printing would look like an F at the beginning of a word, but like an S at the end of the. So there are all these contextual, context-sensitive changes that can happen in Roman fonts. This becomes a huge industry in Devanagari and most other Indian scripts. There are, every time two consonants come together without a vowel between them, the consonants merge together in a new ligature. So Kartsnyam is Greek because it's R-T-S-N-Y, all consonants with no intervening vowel. This string from the R to the Y is all going to be a ligature. And if you look here at the output of Tech, of ZTEC, these little ticks at the bottom are places where the ligature hasn't happened. This little tick is called a virama, it's a stop, a silence, which cancels the inherent vowel. The Sanskrit alphabet is a syllabary, actually, so it's ka. Ka, ga, nga, cha, everything has an a with it, unless you cancel it, and this little sign cancels the vowel. So, actually, that is correct. If you read it out loud, that does say Kartsnyam, but it's really impossible, you know, you couldn't print that in a book. It's technically correct, but just, you know, it doesn't work for proper printing. And there's another one here, this dr should become a dra. Should become a conjunct consonant. There's this D and R, which in the Sanskrit are written together without a space between them. I think in the time I've got, I can't go into the question of spaces and non-spaces in these different alphabets, but typically you don't write spaces between most words in Devanagari. So what's happened here is that the ZTEC is correctly reading Nakula, it's correctly reading input, it's correctly using a Unicode font, but the font is unintelligent. It's not using the font's intelligence. The font has in it all the instructions for making the correct ligatures, but we haven't invoked them. So let's invoke them. Here we put in, when we're setting the main font for Nakula, we are going to say this script is Devanagari, and then we get everything sewn together nicely, all the ligatures in place, everything very nice. And now we can experience ananda, happiness. So finally, with a set of fairly simple commands, you know, you use polyglossia, you use set main font, you use Nakula or some other font which has proper Unicode font properly populated, and you tell it that the script is Devanagari, then really you've got almost everything you need. So let's now look at a slightly more advanced topic. Is that legible from the back? I'm sorry, I've put a lot on the screen, but basically we start off in the same way, document class article, use package font spec, polyglossia. I don't know why I put font spec in, I needn't have, polyglossia calls it. So I'm now going to set two languages. I'm going to set English, and I should have put in brackets the instruction variant equals British. That would give me proper hyphenation. But this will be American. And I've chosen Charis or Charis as my font there because I like it. And then I'm going to set another language which I've called Sanskrit. And I'm setting the new font family for Sanskrit to be Nakula, Sanskrit font. And I've made it narrow. This, don't worry about this, the par indent and text width. This is just so that we can get a very narrow column and force ZTEC to do a lot of hyphenation. So now, the text in Sanskrit, this new font family command automatically generates a new command, which is text and whatever comes before font. So new font family German font, you could then say text German. It would be automatically given to you. So now we've automatically got a text Sanskrit command, and it says manum ekagrama asinam abhigamyam maharshayaha. The great sages came to see Manu, who was sitting concentrated with his mind one-pointed, ekagram. What does this give us? So you need to just look at the source file again. First of all, we've got everything is Romanized, and we've got some that is tagged as being Sanskrit and some that is not. So we've got the Sanskrit hyphenation and the English hyphenation. So this was this was the argument for the text Sanskrit. And eka gram asinam abhigamya. That's very nice. That's just where you would want it. Maharshaya. It works. It's okay. That to the average German, French, Swiss, English, American reader, you know, that means you can typeset a book with lots of Sanskrit words in it in Roman script, and the line breaks will look nice. They'll, you know, they won't offend. If you don't have this proper kind of hyphenation, you get lots and lots of examples in Sanskrit of, you know, Don Knuth's famous examples from the text book, you know, like the rapists looked after the woman, and so on, you know. If we don't switch on, if we don't tag this string as being Sanskrit and allow it to hyphenate as if it were English, we get eka gram, that's okay. Asi nam, that's not too bad. Abhigamya is completely impossible. And this is the kind of horrific hyphenation that people in my professional field see quite a lot in journals and books, because most publishers can't hyphenate automatically for romanized Sanskrit. So this is a hyphenation in the middle of a letter, because in Sanskrit, BH is a single letter of the alphabet. It's a an aspirated letter. So it would be like, I don't know, there's no equivalent in English, but like SH almost, like, you know, in the middle of the sh sound. So, sorry? Yeah, like, yes, exactly. Like in the middle of CH, exactly. And ma harshaya, again, it's a bit nasty. It would, you know, you'd get a little kind of, oh, and then you could read it. But you would be slightly problematic. So, the hyphenation is there. And just also let me say that you've got hyphenation for romanized Sanskrit. What about hyphenation for Sanskrit in the Devanagari script? Well, so we can set up a new font family, and we've been using Nakula still, and here we've got that the script is Devanagari, and we're using a mapping. Now, this is new. This is a TEC file, a TEC, part of this TEC kit, this process for manipulating strings. And this is a little file, it's not complicated, I can show it to you if I've got time, which basically maps romanized Sanskrit. It says what each letter, it's more or less a table, there's a bit more to it, but a table of letters and a table of their equivalents in Roman on the left and Devanagari on the right, roughly speaking. So now what I've set up here is that my Sanskrit font family is going to be text Sanskrit as it was before, and I'm going to write in Roman script as before. So all of this at the bottom there is the same. But I'm going to get my output, like that. Sorry, yes, so I did a second screen here just to tell you that all I'd done was to change that line, new font family. That's the only change in the file. And there's the output now, Sanskrit hyphenation, and on the left, manume ka gram asinam abhigamya maharshayaha. It works rather well. It's well hyphenated. The hyphenation tables for Sanskrit that have been done by Yves Cordet and others, and Jonathan, have actually got tables in them for Sanskrit in many different scripts. So you can have the one, because it's Unicode, so they can make different hyphenation rules for the different parts of the Unicode plane. So they've got correct hyphenation for Sanskrit in Bengali, Sanskrit in Gujarati, Sanskrit in Devanagari, and also Sanskrit in Roman. It's great. So a single hyphenation file can, that's why you can have Devanagari hyphenated correctly, and you can have Roman hyphenated differently, but also correctly. I don't know, for someone in my field, this is really heaven. You wouldn't expect a piece of software to do this, and it's really, really great. And on the right-hand side is the English hyphenation, which is pretty much wrong as before. So just very briefly to scoot forward, actually at this point I want to do a little live demonstration. I was talking with some colleagues yesterday, and we all decided that live demonstrations are a very bad idea. So and this is why, because they don't work. And I can't get the windows Okay, there's a window, and then can I get the output? Well, the output is in another window. Oh, well, we'll just have to do our best. Damn it, now I can't find anything. Maybe I'll just leave the live demonstration. I can't find my input window. It's there somewhere, but it's gone. It's behind something. Oh well, sorry about that. What I was going to demonstrate is basically that you can have your input in Roman, just as you've been seeing, and get your output in Roman. You can just say mapping equals Devanagari, mapping equals ROMDev, and then you get this output. So you don't change anything that's between begin and end document. It stays the same. And your input may be Roman, and you can choose to have your output in Roman or in Devanagari. It's amazing. It really, so it's a very nice thing to demonstrate. Not only that, as I mentioned, in my professional community, there have been quite a number of ad hoc kludges that have built up over the years of little private code, private encoding systems and so on. So you can actually make, you can rescue your legacy documents. If you've got something that uses, for example, the Feldhaus, Franz Feldhaus created an input system for Sanskrit that went together with his beautiful metafont for Devanagari, and many people doing Sanskrit and Hindi and Tech had been using the Feldhaus system called Devnag, which is hosted here on the server here. A lot of us have done books and articles and so on. There's a lot of stuff out there that uses that. And his input was not Unicode, because when he invented it, that didn't exist yet. He made long vowels by saying AA, and letter with a dot under it would be just dot and that letter. So he invented his own Roman input system, which is very easy to type and very easy to understand. It's just private. It's his sui generis system. But we've got a translation. We've got a tech table now, a TEC table, that translates Feldhaus into Devanagari. So this exact same output, this is the beginning of the Yoga Sutras with the commentary of King Bhoja, so this exact same output you can have in Feldhaus encoding or in Unicode encoding, and just by saying mapping equals ROMDev or mapping equals Feldhaus, you get the right output. Again, it's kind of a miracle for people who work in this field. I'm sorry I couldn't show it to you more clearly. And finally, I've been doing quite separately, some corpus work on Sanskrit, building a system that I call Sarit. This is all out in the public, sarit.indology.info, where we're trying to build a corpus of Sanskrit texts the right way. There are a few websites out there that are hosting large amounts of Sanskrit literature, mostly in transliteration, but they're all just chucking either ASCII or Unicode at everybody without proper documentation. You don't often know where it came from or what encoding it may use, although some of that is done better in some places. But clearly the proper way to build a corpus of literature is to use XML and the Text Encoding Initiative guidelines. So that's what I've started this project here, and it's still very much a pilot project, but we've got actually a reasonable amount of text already. I mean, it's very small compared with our goals. We're aiming at a very large corpus. But this is just one text, and here's all of this Romanized stuff. Now, I presented all of this to a group of colleagues in Delhi at the Rashtriya Sanskrit Sansthan, the National Sanskrit University, and they were quite excited about it. They wanted to collaborate, and there's a possibility of funding and rooms full of people sweating over keyboards and all of this. So it's sort of quite an interesting possible collaboration. But they can't see this. They can't work in Romanized Sanskrit. It's got to be Devanagari for them. So my colleague Andrew Ollett at Columbia has just recently done this. This is a Prakrit text. Prakrit is a derivative, just as Dante's Latin is to Cicero's Latin. So Prakrit is to Sanskrit. It's a derivative language, a middle medieval language, halfway between Sanskrit and Hindi, say, or Sanskrit and Marathi. So this is an interesting. It's a Prakrit text written by a Muslim author from Gujarat. And here we have it, and Andrew is using it with his students. He's made a very nice website. Can I do something so you can actually see it all? Sorry, it's all spilling off the right there. So, for example, here's a verse in Devanagari, and if you toggle the commentary, there's a later commentary. You can toggle the a second commentary, Avachurika, and you can toggle the translations. So this is all very nice, but what's even better is up at the top here, you can press a button and get the whole thing in Roman transliteration. Well, you could. I've never seen this not work before in my whole life. So let's try another one. Here's one that I prepared earlier. And here it all is in Roman script. Again, toggling, and it's all Roman. There are some extra things here that are really nice, sort of mouth-watering, a bit like tooltips that we've just seen yesterday. So stuff in blue is stuff where different manuscripts have different readings. So if you hover, you see that manuscript P has a gap at that place, and manuscript J has a different reading. So all of the different manuscript readings you can see just by hovering over the blue text. But that's just eye candy. What I really wanted to show you here is this instant conversion between Devanagari and transliteration. So, but it's not working still. At least you saw it work once. All this work that Andrew is doing with these online transliteration systems is coming from the use of a toolkit that IBM has put out for working with Unicode, the so-called ICU toolkit. I can't remember now. Somebody, I'm sure, here knows what that stands for, but there's a website and support for it and a lot of free downloadable stuff. And Andrew has used the tech kit materials that were developed for transliterating Sanskrit within the ZTEC world, and with very little work indeed, fed those to this ICU library so that it can do on-the-fly transliteration of selected strings inside XML documents. So the technology that started within the ZTEC community is now getting out into enabling these things to be represented on the web very smoothly between Devanagari or Romanization, according to the different readerships. And this, I think, is going to be a game changer in my negotiations with the group in Delhi, because if I can show them my Sarit text corpus and say, you just press this button, you get it all in Devanagari, then suddenly it's going to be something they really want. So there we are. The good guys are listed there. These are actually just some of the people who've worked so hard to make all of these tools possible. And there are some people also not mentioned there at all as well. I just listed the most prominent ones. So thank you very much to all the people on this list. And thank you for staying with me on this last talk when you're all dying to get away. Thank you very much.
Gripping talk, even though I didn't understand half of it, but any questions?
I felt the same about yours.
Well, there was more content. Just a moment. Questions, please. One of you Indian guys, you must have. Catching on top of this.
So, Google is perfect. Google translates it.
For data entry, yes. So you can type very.
You're talking about the local use of Krishna, right? So if they do the Krishna.
Yes.
Or the WA stuff, you do get the right one.
It's good, isn't it? Yes, I'm aware of it, and it's nice.
But it's kind of, the license is with the key, but you can use it as an API.
Mm. Okay, so that's something that you can incorporate into a website.
But this ICU thing is different in the sense that this uses your Romanized version, in the sense of IPA kind of thing.
Yes. Yes.
So that way, this is different. The sense that it's not the common day-to-day user.
Yes, that's right. It's something that exists within the scholarly community.
So
that's right.
The ICU doesn't work with this Google Translate.
You're saying it doesn't?
No.
I don't know. I think not. I mean, ICU is a. No, I think it doesn't. It's just a completely different suite of programs. No, you can write tables for anything to anything with ICU. Normally, anything to Unicode. So, I think you could write tables to go from anything you wanted. But it's not. You wouldn't want to call up the Google API because it's the ICU stuff is doing some of the same work, but just doing it somewhat differently. I mean, the Google material is for the keying in. It's actually when you type, it turns what you're typing into an Indian script from phonetic.
Wait till the word is finished.
Yes. So this is not designed for saying here's a 4 megabyte file, please give it to me in Roman or give it to me in Devanagari or give it to me in Malayalam. That's what the IBM ICU libraries do. They're for bulk transliteration and bulk conversion of large XML files.
So even the Google one doesn't allow you the license to pull it up because you want it in your.
But it could, for some people, it could really solve the problem of how to type. You know, if they're really just, if you just wanted to type a little and, you know, you didn't really need to install something to make it, you know, a smooth process on your own machine, but you just wanted it, you know, you want a tattoo, or your daughter wants a tattoo, so, you know, you want to, you know, Om Namah Shivaya or something, so then the Google API might be jolly helpful. You know, for people who would like just a solution for quickly typing something and getting it in an Indian script.
Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
End of the day.